This is our second annual Jobs Creators Day, and hopefully it's a tradition that the economic development community will continue forward in it for future years. Thank you for making your trek up to Santa Fe, if you came from far. If you just came from around the corner, thank you as well. And I know several of you are up here for a New Mexico idea, and it will count as a multi-day commitment to be up here. So thanks again. We're going to improvise a little bit on schedule, or the flow of the agenda. We have two representatives who are going to speak, who are great advocates and supporters for economic development. And we're going to do a little bit of a panel with some of our companies that have grown and succeeded and thrived through our programs. And then I'll pepper in some comments throughout the day. But as part of that improvisation, I'm actually just going to open up and invite Representative Larrañaga, who's standing on my left, to come up and share a few words. Representative Larrañaga has been a great partner for economic development. He was one of the folks who really advocated hard for funding LEADA on a permanent basis to the $50 million over the last several years, and is always quick to factually highlight the successes of the department and really just speak to the importance of economic development and what it means to our state. And what it does that goes beyond the pure funding of the program. I'm going to steal the saying he uses a lot, but the best social program is creating a job. And that is something that he likes to say a lot, and I borrowed it, and I just stole it again from you. But that is, I think all of us as economic developers, we carry that in our heart, we carry that in our mind, and we're out there doing our job on a daily basis. So, Representative, if you'd like to step forward, and we can get you off to your 2 o'clock appointment.
Probably the most underrepresented group are the job creators. You know why? They're working at their jobs. And so we don't see much of you, but you know what? Nothing helps anyone any more than a job. A job is what we try to do as a priority here, and we have over the last years that I've been here, and I will continue to look at that. You know, earlier today, Amazon released their finalists for their new North America headquarters. We were one of those folks, City of Albuquerque and others, who threw our names in that pot. Out of the 238 proposals, they received 20 metro areas made the final design of the first country. New Mexico's neighbors, Colorado, and Texas have 3 cities that made that cut. Unfortunately, New Mexico's 2 applicants did not, Albuquerque and Doniana County. Amazon laid out the blueprint for what business won in their host city. They want a vibrant community, primed for growth. They want a tech-savvy workforce rich in STEM skills and knowledge. For an engineer like me, there's no sweeter words than when you say it: science, technology, engineering, and math. And that is the world we live in today. That's where the competition is. That's where the workforce has to be to make us competitive. They want a high quality of life for their employees, including good schools, safe neighborhoods, convenient transportation, plenty of recreational opportunities, and the list goes on. But those are some of the major factors. Finally, they want a business-friendly regulatory environment that promotes jobs. Promotes job creations and a healthy economy. New Mexico has made some great strides over the past 7 years to improve our ability to compete with other states, attract new investment, and support our homegrown businesses. Among those programs is, as the Secretary said, the Local Economic Development Act, which we funded 3 years ago to a minimum, or at that time, $50 million to be able to make us competitive. The other side is the STIP, the training program that we have. Because the workforce has to be trained, and those emphases replaced, and we funded those. And we continue to fight for funding for these programs. But clearly, you can tell losing to some other cities, like Dallas, Denver, and some of those, we need to work a lot more. We need to improve our policies to build what everybody is considering to be a 21st century economy. We have to start with our tax code. New Mexico's current gross receipts tax system dates back to 1969. If this were a person, it would be eligible for the AARP next year. I know. As you can tell, the current gross receipts tax was built for a world without personal computer, without smartphones, without overnight delivery in 1969 here in New Mexico. That's not good enough. You know, New Mexico's GRT hurts small businesses, discourages individuals and innovative ideas from developing new businesses and growing businesses in New Mexico. Worse, the pyramid, the effect of that creates and raises costs for everyone, businesses and consumer alike. I know. I was in the consulting engineering business for nearly 20 years after a little stint in government. And competition from Texas, when we had to compete with them, competition from Arizona in their taxes always gave the advantage to those companies whose headquarters were located in those states. We need to reform that. We need to have a tax reform, and we need it as quickly as we possibly can. We cannot compete in this state without some kind of reform. As New Mexico's job creators, you provide the backbone for our state's economy. You are the drivers of the economy. And you know, as I said at the onset, you are not representative because it's so sexy, feels so compassionate. It feels a lot better when you say, let's create another social program. And it's okay, we need some social programs. But you know what? Along with those social programs, we need, as the secretary said, and I always like to say, the best social program is a job, is a job, is a job. And I can't say it enough because I really believe that. And you guys know, with your workforce, with the people you employ, how much better off they are when they have a job. Their families are improved, their social life is improved, their economy is improved, everything around them, environment just changes in every possible way. And someone has a job. So, finally, and I've got to run to a meeting, I want to thank you guys for coming today to share your experiences. If I get finished up there, I'll go back down here. And concerns with us. We need to hear those. And you know, there's nothing like being partners. Let's work together, create jobs, and make New Mexico citizens better citizens by being productive and being good citizens with finding a good paying job. Thank you so very much.
Representative, thank you very much. I really appreciate those comments. And I encourage everyone in the audience to really think about and contemplate the representative's comments on tax reform. As as economic developers, you all work in the realm of BR&E, business retention and expansion, keeping the companies that are in your communities there and helping them foster. And there are some disadvantages to our tax code that encourage multi-state corporations to do certain functions outside of our state because of the way that the tax code is created. And then for the companies that are solely located in New Mexico, they can be at a cost disadvantage because of pyramiding. So please listen and monitor and keep an eye on tax reform. This year, as they work on it, Representative Larrañaga is obviously a champion for that. And that's part of just building a better, stronger business climate for us as a state. I'm going to bring some folks up here. I'm going to start with the man in the trench coat against the column, who knows his way around this building quite well. Is Susan Kelly from Raytheon here? Has Susan made it yet? Come on, there, sorry. And the guy in the trench coat is taking off his hat, Mark Fidel with RiskSense. John from TRC Brewing, if you want to come on up here. And do I have Jonathan Green of CIG Logistics? There you are, okay. And then, so we'll start with you four. Step over there. Kind of have a prepped question, and then, you know, so you get a chance to answer a question, and then like a little bit of open mic. The challenge is don't say what the person before you said at the open mic, so. we'll go with ladies first, definitely. And what I mean by that is, obviously, you know, if you can expand it and put the previous person's comments, that's really good. So we'll start with Susan from Raytheon, and I'm going to paraphrase a little bit what Ben wrote up. First, Raytheon is a long-term partner in job creation here in New Mexico, in Albuquerque, as well as in the Four Corners of the Navajo Nation, with your two facilities. You've had expansions over the last couple of years using our tools at both of those facilities. You have specialized missions supporting our armed forces. Can you speak to how we help the development of your new Albuquerque manufacturing facility, as well as supporting the expansion and on NAVI? I think it would be interesting for you to also talk about it in the context of, we know Raytheon has many options when you look at expanding across the country. I know Raytheon pretty well, and when these opportunities present themselves, it seems to be that we're competing with 4 to 6 other states when these opportunities present themselves. So you can talk about the tools and then how that helps New Mexico position itself vis-a-vis the other locations of Raytheon. We greatly appreciate it.
So first of all, the Raytheon Albuquerque location, we have kind of three main missions that we serve for the company, for the warfighter. One of our areas is directed energy. We do high power microwave, pulse power, and particle beam research and development. One way that the LIDA funds have helped us in that is, the tax reform. There is no gross receipts tax on directed energy. That has enabled us to keep the directed energy work right here in New Mexico where it belongs, and we're creating jobs. I'll get to that in a minute. Another major area we have where we've got most of our contracts in Albuquerque is an area we call long range. We're providing the equipment that goes on test ranges around the world. One of our biggest contracts is with the Commonwealth of Australia. We're putting our test equipment that's produced and made right here in New Mexico all the way to Woomera test range in Australia, which is the largest So the work we're doing here is very important to the company, but it's also very important to the defense of the nation around the world. So that's key. The third area we do is energetics. We're pretty small on that. We do a lot of work for Sandia and Los Alamos on that. The LIDA funds, though, that we have received last year helped us open a third facility in Albuquerque. That was primarily to serve our Woomera program that I just mentioned. Without that, I would not have been able to keep the jobs in New Mexico. And also, by the way, if anybody here has a college degree, we're hiring. We have currently 17 openings. My gut thinks we need about 40. And I've also been challenged to grow our site by 2 times in the next 5 years. So we're looking to stay in New Mexico. We're looking to stay in Albuquerque. The space has also allowed us not just to grow the mobile range side of the house, but we moved from our cramped facility that we had for the past few years to this new facility, so that allowed our directed energy side to expand as well. So we're seeing growth in both sides of our business to service the warfighter, and it's just really exciting and fantastic. Now, the Dene facility that's up in Farmington also received some funds last year. We built an entirely new warehouse for that. We are actually in production manufacturing some key missile systems up there that we sell all over the world. Financially, for the company, even though we're not the headquarters here in New Mexico, we are very valued by the company in Tucson because of that Farmington facility. The work that they do there is just really fantastic, and so the tax incentive that we get really is key to that, keeping that work here, participating with the Indian Nation to make sure we train those people and keep the work here, and also hire tons of them out. So that's it.
Just a little background on you know, my personal experience with Raytheon. Last year, shortly before coming on board here, I was still in the city of Rio Rancho, and I was preparing for a trip with the governor and some other economic developers to the Boston area, and we're looking to drum up appointments. And one of the things I do when we're going on these trips is I go to the alumni database from my alma mater, and it turns out that the CEO of Raytheon is studied at UCLA, and he has his personal email address on the alumni database, which I found very interesting. And so I said, why not? I'm going to send him an email. 7 minutes later, I got an email back from the CEO of Raytheon saying, New Mexico is very important to us. We look forward to meeting with you. And he copied his ad and said, clear my schedule to meet with the New Mexico team. And I think it spoke very interestingly to the company culture, that he was so accessible, and then that we're able to be, you know, with Dr. Kelly, with Tom Kelly. So yeah, so it was Dr. Kennedy. Yes, not your doctor, you're Kelly. I apologize. But it was very insightful and spoke to the commitment that they had for our company. Next, I'm going to hand the mic over to Mark Fidel, who's with RiskSense. RiskSense is at the forefront in a lot of ways in the poster child or the face, however we want to describe it, the tech transfer. Entrepreneurial startup here in New Mexico. You're a great industry leader in cyber risk management, but you're also a great story of tech transfer coming out of one of the universities and growing up an industry leader right here in Albuquerque. Can you talk about that and how the tools have helped you?
Thank you, Secretary Geisel. Thank you, staff of the Economic Development Department. You've been extremely effective and efficient at what you do to help us grow. RiskSense is a New Mexico-based Delaware C company that's transitioned from a three-member limited liability company. One of those three members was the New Mexico Tech University Research Park Corporation. The other member was our CEO, Srinivas Mukhamal. There will be a test later on if you can pronounce his name. And then the third member was myself. In 2015, those individuals and the entity agreed to form RiskSense Incorporated because for two main reasons, so that we can use stock options as incentives for as part of total compensation, so that we can compete nationally for the work that we need, and the other is so that we can work easier with outside investors. Both of those goals have been met since 2015. We're past our Series A and we've grown. We are very much JTIP eligible. To be JTIP eligible means that your out-of-state sales are more than 50% of your total sales. And we are approximately 80-20. 80% of our sales are out-of-state in New Mexico. The reverse is essentially true with our workforce. We're about 105 people nationwide. 77 are in Albuquerque. Okay? Those that are out of state are regional sales managers, marketing team in Sunnyvale, some of our C-suite in Sunnyvale, but the brunt of our workforce is here. Of that 105, about 35% of the workforce in total are software developers and engineers. That's why JTIP is important to us. We want to hire locally as best we can. The calculus that JTIP means for us is for every four $100,000 jobs, we get reimbursed for one of those every year for JTIP eligibility. Now, that's not the math that you have to go through to prove JTIP, but that's how it works out for us. And we moved, because of Srinivas, our CEO, he's still a senior research scientist at New Mexico Tech. The school didn't want to compete with the private sector except where they could. And so through their research park corporation, they have, they're the single largest shareholder, they're not a majority, but they're the single largest shareholder of a private for-profit entity. And it's a great arrangement. It's worked out well both for the school and certainly for the company. And we had a very good year last year. We're looking to continue to grow and get into the JTIF application stream. So I hope that answered the question.
Thank you very much. Very insightful. And, you're definitely, you know, excited to see you grow. Great representative of what can happen for tech startups, entrepreneurial startup tech champion here in New Mexico. Speaking of tech, we're going to talk to a former tech startup executive who is employing his entrepreneurship skills in a completely different, very tasty way. John Masterson is with Truth or Consequences Brewing. A microbrew is a manufacturing process. If you wonder, how does beer making count for our programs? It is manufacturing. But one of the things that we also look for when we are supporting breweries is the opportunity to have a real ripple effect with their support. And John and his wife, I'll let him tell his story, I can't tell it, but they are providing a catalytic effect to the TRC Main Street area. So that was one of the things that we recognized as an opportunity in supporting them, is that the impact that they would have in the Main Street area of Truth or Consequences would go beyond the four doors of their building and beyond the media job they're creating. It was going to help revitalize that Main Street corridor. So that's what we're really excited about as we all make our drive for the TRC and, you know, check in or overnight TRC when we're traveling across the state. So, John, can you talk a little bit about your path and the tools that we use for that?
So roll back to 2015 or so, my wife Marianne and I were on just a tourist vacation in New Mexico discovering things. By the way, she really wanted to be here today, but she could not be here because she was literally interviewing and hiring a human position this month. So she's a better speaker too. So we were coming through and we discovered this wonderful, artsy, quirky little town and realized we had been working in the technology industry up in Seattle, and we discovered this town and we said, we need to figure out how to have a life here. We don't know if it's going to be as a vacation property or what it's going to be, but we need to figure out how to have a life here. In the lake, in the river, in the mountain, the people, in the galleries, and the cafes, it was just a wonderful little town. And so we decided to get a beer and talk about it. There was not a beer to be found, and the idea was born. We had experience in running businesses and technical project management and business metrics, and I had experience as a home brewer, and we decided to make a go of it. What we were not, in fact, was commercial real estate developers. And so when we moved into this wonderful little town and bought a historic 1926 building that seemed to have running water and a flushing toilet and even lights inside, we thought we were well on our way to opening a brewery. But in fact, it turns out that commercial manufacturing needs a lot more than that. And so we needed to rip out all of the utilities and replace everything. And so as the project sort of blossomed in time and money beyond what our tech industry savings would allow, began talking to local banks in the local office of Main Street. Main Street Truth or Consequences was an invaluable partner and had been sort of informing us about the variety of the programs available. Christine Logan, and then we were introduced to, and she shepherded us through the process of LIDA. LIDA was a perfect fit for us because we were both investing in infrastructure and providing manufacturing jobs. And so we were finally able to open in June of just this last year. We had our first brew in August on the day of the solar eclipse, that is known as Cosmic Blonde. Please come down and visit us. By the way, the brewery is right in the center of the historic downtown. The historic downtown of Truth or Consequences is sitting on top of an underground lake of 110 degree water. And this wonderful hot mineral water is coming up in springs inside the hotel rooms that surround the brewery. So if you have not made a damage to the consequences, please come visit us. The Cosmic Blonde and the Mineral Waters are waiting. If it were not for Leah, we would not have been able to complete the project in a manner that ensured that we were properly capitalized, that we had the right type of utility connections, that we were able to hit the ground running. So it was a perfect program for us. And thank you, Christine and Juan, and the city and the wonderful people of Chippewa Consequences, and really all of New Mexico. Y'all find yourself a beautiful, beautiful state. We are super grateful to be here.
John, thank you very much. We're going to have one more speaker, and then we're going to go to our featured representative from the House Appropriations. We'll come up at a little bit of a halftime, and then we'll do a back half of our companies. So Jonathan, you're kind of like a two-minute warning, if you will. Like, you have more than 2 minutes, take your time, but it's kind of like that commercial, you know, leading into it. Jonathan of CIT Logistics. CIT Logistics is a trusted logistics partner for large-scale transloading and storage services for the extractives industry, based in southeastern Michigan. I used to live in southeastern Michigan, my apologies. Southeastern New Mexico. Their large-scale gel terminal includes more than 550 rail car spots and 12,000 tons of silo storage capacity. Jonathan, can you give us a little bit of a background on what your company does, and then talk how business growth motivated your decision to expand CIG to New Mexico, and how JTIP is helping you train your workforce to be successful?
Transloading, by definition, is the change of mode of transportation. So, simple version, what we do is things come in on rail and they leave on truck, or they come in on truck and they leave on rail. So, we build large scale rail facilities across the United States. We have 16 facilities in 6 states, I believe, right now. We have 19 in 7 states by the end of the year. You're building, actually, I think the same way. We're building the largest transloading facility in the United States in Lundstrom, New Mexico. It'll be completed probably about another 30 days, something like that. It'll be a big ribbon cutting, and you'll probably read about this in the Wall Street Journal because of who some of our partners are. But, we were able to do that because of the job training funds that the state of New Mexico offers. What you all do is unique. And what it allowed us to do is pre-hire employees for this facility and actually start training in our jobs. So we can start as being able to have running or train workforce. That way it minimizes execution risk, which allows us to keep customers and allows us to continue to grow. Through building this facility, some of our customers came to us and said, actually, you're handling the change of mode of transportation. Could you actually get the products all the way to the final destination? So December 15th of this year, we acquired a company, it's a Canadian company, but we'll be adding 1,200 jobs this year to our already, I don't know how many employees. But that's all because of these minor programs where we had, I don't know, 60 jobs that were going to be created and loving, because now we're going to be something much larger. And of those 1,200 people, I would guess half of them probably end up coming from the state of New Mexico, the other half from Texas, up from other regions. But we're very appreciative for what the state of New Mexico has done for us. I was actually born and raised in college.
Such large-scale incremental expansion in southeastern New Mexico is very, very good to hear, obviously, as we're seeing some nice uptick in the oil field right now. So that's fantastic. Thank you so much for that. So what I would like to do now is welcome Representative Lundstrom. She is the chair of House Appropriations, as I mentioned earlier today. Sometimes I call her Madam Chair. Sometimes I call her representative, sometimes I call her Patty, depends on the context of the conversation. But Representative Lundstrom, the Chair of House Appropriations. First and foremost, I think on behalf of everyone that's in this room, thank you for your continued support of economic development. We enjoy working with you from all sides of the table in the process of growing New Mexico's economy. Thank you.
Because One of the issues I spent a lot of time on with my colleagues is to explain why incentives are important. Why that extra investment into things like LIDA or JTIP or foreign direct investment, whatever it happens to be, is important is because it is a tool for us. It's something that we can talk to companies about. And it's not easy. I mean, if it was easy, we would have all kinds of new companies into New Mexico, big job growth, but it isn't. I mean, it takes a lot of time, and it's a heck of a lot of hard work. We can hold the hand of a company for months and months and months, and have Matt and Tim come in and help hold that person's hand and still not see them come to New Mexico. That's hard to explain. But what I tell my board is, it's not just about the number of jobs that's created, it's that foundation that we've built to bring in those jobs. Can I see a show of hands of how many agree with me on that? I want to thank you. I mean, because I've been beating the drum on that with everybody who listened to me about it, and the people that disagree have never tried to bring a company into New Mexico. With that, Mr. Secretary, back up there and listen to those budgets that are being presented today. And again, thank you all for being here. You got a friend on HAFC, you got a colleague in the field, and again, thanks for coming out and supporting Job Creators Day.
Can we give her a big round of applause, please? Madam Chair, thank you very much. I'd like to bring up the next group of some companies that we have here to talk a little bit about their experiences in New Mexico. So Amanda, Mitch, Leah, it's cheese, and we're losing this microphone here a little bit. Rene from PreCheck. Allison? Yeah, Allison from New York. And I saw Joe from USA Beef earlier. Is he still around? Anyone see Joe? If someone sees Joe, go ahead and drag him up here. So, and we will work on getting the microphone that has batteries, because it's going to keep on cutting in and out, I think. Amanda, we'll start with you. You're right next to me. You guys actually kind of line up and almost. Because that's how I call you guys up. Amanda, Descartes Labs is a revolutionary company developing artificial intelligence technology that analyzes petabytes of data. So you have to explain what a petabyte is. That's part of your answer, is it? Or someone Google what a petabyte is. From thousands of mobile satellites. Can you speak to how LIDA is helping you build your corporate headquarters here in Santa Fe? And how JTIP is helping bring in new workforce to expand your company? Your growth, the market share, who you are, in, you know, how economic development's been able to play a small bit of your entrepreneurial success.
So I was one of those guys who traveled through Albuquerque, actually hitchhiking through in 1981, looking for a place to land, and fell in love with New Mexico. I moved here for the quality of life. I was one of those long-haired hippie dudes living the lifestyle, and it fit really quite well. I was into natural products at that time. Still am into my business. We manufacture dietary supplements, herbal supplements, nutraceuticals. And when I first came here, I was literally enchanted with Albuquerque and New Mexico as a whole. Decided to establish Vitality Works October 2nd, 1982. While we haven't had a business plan, we are now about 235 people, we're more than 50 million in sales. We're one of the larger nutraceutical herbal manufacturers in the United States. We're independent, we're private, had tremendous growth. Up until 2011, I was doing it on my own with our team. And that was through a lot of right place, right time, heavily reinvesting in the company, living below our means, and establishing ourselves nationwide. In 2011, we purchased a facility that was dramatically larger than our needs. It was the old Honeywell building in Albuquerque, which was 110,000 square feet on 22 acres of land. And that's when we started to tap into what the state, city, county had to offer. It was our first endeavor into JTIPs, an IRB, and a new market tax credit through the New Mexico Finance Authority. And since then, we've also participated in high wage tax credits and LEDA. And all of these have really helped us to grow much faster and reduce risk and take chances in ways we probably would not have otherwise. We are now manufacturing and gain market share. We do manufacture for about 960 brands. We do not manufacture our own brand. We're the guys who really make this stuff. And it would be hard to find a household in the United States that does not, if you're into any kind of supplements, dietary supplements, nutraceuticals, there's a good chance something in your cabinet came from our facility in Albuquerque. Because we manufacture, like I said, for 963 companies from the Sprouts brand to Whole Foods to Vitamin Shoppe and Amazon. We do a lot of Amazon, so a lot of Amazon dollars coming through New Mexico, as well as small mom and pops. So we try to support local. We have growers in New Mexico from Marshall Mason's old place up in Amicu Farms, Suque Pueblo. We try to support local. 99.99% of our revenue comes in from out of state. Over 60% stays here. We're looking for, we just right now for, it's like starting to go. For another new market tax credit, we're looking, when we applied for our first one in 2011, we thought we would hire 40 people over 5 years, and we hired 140 people over 5 years. We're projecting to have another 60 people over the next 5 years, we're raring to go with that right now. We also invest in training people in GMP, FDA-regulated industries. We think the training that we provide for people is a skill set they can carry throughout the rest of their lives. So we are training people. The JTIPs help in those endeavors quite a bit. And we're involved with ARCA and hiring disadvantaged folks. We're hiring people that would not get jobs because they have felons, and we're rehabilitating people. We're really trying to look, while we have high-wage jobs and executives, we're looking at all fields of folks who need a job, teaching them job skills, teaching them what the correct culture is like to be successful in their life, and that's part of our mission. So we're excited to be here. We're knee-deep in here, and we're going to continue.
Our next speaker is Rene Hatfield of PreCheck. PreCheck is an employment and background screening firm specializing in the healthcare industry. They came to New Mexico planning on only having a small operation in Alamogordo for business continuity purposes after their headquarters main office had been hit by a hurricane. But after coming here, and over the last, I think it's 12-ish years or so, it became obvious that New Mexico is a great place for them to do business. They've grown up from a handful of employees to, I think, nearly 200. PreCheck has utilized LEDA and JTIP over these years to expand and create jobs. As I mentioned, they're in Alamogordo. It's a great complementary employer to the Air Force Base for the people in the community. Can you talk a little bit about the experience of PreCheck in New Mexico?
Hi, everyone. So a little bit of background about PreCheck. We just celebrated 11 years on January 7th. It was very exciting for us. We started out with a class of 5 to 7. I may have been 7. And we just had a handful of our people just get their awards yesterday for their 10 and 11 years with PreCheck. So we started out with 7 people. We are close to 200 people at this time. We were awarded, thank you. When the building was built, it was built in 2 parts. We were going to occupy 1 section, and then we had PreCheck Real Estate. We were going to offer the other side. Well, when the hurricane struck, right directly thereafter that, we realized that we were so grateful that we had built that building. We brought our Houston folks, our investigators, over to New Mexico, and New Mexico became our operational hub, PreCheck. We do have an office in Houston, Texas. That's where our C-suite, our IT sales folks are at, but our operational hub is here in New Mexico. We occupied that other space, and throughout the years, we have grown quickly, and with the help of JTIP, and we were awarded a LEADA fund in 2015, and it enabled us to expand our infrastructure inside of our building. We had to take our very large 100-7500 person conference room and break it up to extra office space, create a world-class training room for our investigators, and so we were able to utilize the LEADA fund to expand internally the existing building. Today, we are completely busted at the seams. I cannot put another light. We reorganized our cubicles for maximum capacity with that LEADA award, and now we're just going to have to build on. So I'm asking for some more money. we're going to need it. And so with the JTIP funds, we've had 9 different proposals to the state. The state has been the staff, the JTIP staff, Sarah and Teresa have been fantastic, as well as the New Mexico partnership, Mark and Susie and Tim. Everybody, Secretary Geisel, has always been there. Anytime I've called, if there's been a need, they've been there and said, how can we help you grow? How can we help you win? And that's what PreCheck values so much, is the partnership we have with the entire state of New Mexico. But developmentally, we have continued to grow our staff. We take advantage of many different incentives, high wage tax credit, real tax credit, WIOA funds. Anything that we can get our hands on in order for us to grow, we have our hands on it. So it's there, we're going to take advantage of it. We appreciate the state of New Mexico very much.
Thank you very much. You started to sound a little bit like Mitch towards the end. Because, I mean, it's in a good way, because Mitch at his AAB speech said something very important. And he almost went off on a rant, and it was a good rant. I hear people talk about the business climate, and he said, New Mexico got a great business climate, and there are tools out there for you to take advantage of. Get off your you-know-what. And get your business growing. It's pretty much what Mitch said to 500 people. And Rene, you started the channel with Mitch a little bit right there. So, no, I know, but it's just, you guys are like, you're in sync with one another. Next, we have Leah Jackson from Southwest Cheese. And, you know, I just was out in Clovis, I guess in December, November. Southwest Cheese is one of the largest single-site manufacturers of premium quality cheese and whey protein in the world. I think they have a really interesting way of saying it. When you ask them the question, are you the biggest cheese manufacturing facility in the world? They say, I think the answer is, we do not. They don't claim to be the largest, but they say, we don't know of anyone bigger. I think it's also exemplified by 10% of the cheese that is consumed in this country comes from Clovis, New Mexico. So if you mind up, 10 slices of cheese. At least part of them came from Clovis. And you are creating very meaningful job creation in rural New Mexico. My understanding is employment numbers are close to 400. And in addition to obviously being a cheese processing facility, that means you are supporting dairy farmers and dairy farmers' families across rural New Mexico and rural Texas as well. So it's not just the jobs there, it's a sustainment, meaningful rural. Rural jobs and farms across the Southwest. So I'd like to ask you to share some thoughts for us.
Space that's really incredible. They're making
you know, hit on a couple things just, you know, that I heard, and, you know, I kind of sometimes call us clean up. I make notes throughout the presentation and write some things down. But one, J-Tip, I think a theme we heard from all companies is J-Tip is used to reinvest in the employee. One of the things that we heard companies talk about is they're able to train their employees longer thanks to J-Tip, and that leads to more effective, more productive, happier, safer employees. And I think that's just a win-win. We speak a lot about J-Tip as building the workforce. The other thing I heard a lot of the companies talk about is they're hiring. And there's a lot of talk, I think anecdotally, sometimes it's in the newspaper, of people talk about, you know, some kids graduate from college, they go to another state, net migration, those type of comments. If you have friends and families who are from New Mexico and have moved out of state, let them know there are jobs here. And I come across a lot of people who say, I would move home to New Mexico, you know, I will move home to New Mexico when I find that right job. You know, we heard a lot of companies talk about that. Raytheon, RiskSense, TRC Brewing is also hiring. And any of these companies that are the J-Tip applicants, they're regularly hiring. So put that word out. Or when you have friends and family come home for Thanksgiving or Christmas and they tell you there are no jobs in New Mexico, tell them they're wrong. Okay? Call Sarah. She'll give you the inside information on who's hiring and where we can point them. And really important to acknowledge that it's a broad array of types of jobs that we're here and talk about. Before I start to wrap up, I think I'd be remiss to not ask the staff that's here from the Economic Development Department to kind of stand up. If you do not know them, make sure you do know them. You get the business card. These are the people who make it happen. They are the ones that make it happen. When I go to a meeting and take notes and say, we'll work on it, those are the people who work on it. So thank you very much to the staff. It was very nice to hear you guys get the recognition from the speakers today for the work that you guys do behind the scenes. One other thing, you know, I just did, as I wrap up and I talk about getting to know the staff, you know, this room here is your peers. It's your peer companies that, you know, from company to company, you guys can share best practices on how you're growing and staying in New Mexico. Economic developers is for someone in the state that you have not met. Swap business cards to meet someone new today. Networking sounds like a little bit of a cliche, but, you know, it's an overused term, but it's also a very important thing to do. So take advantage of that. Again, I appreciate everyone being up here today. And if you didn't get this RAD card today, this succinctly summarizes the Economic Development Department's legislative priorities for the session. I'm not going to regurgitate what's on here or what you've already heard today, but make sure you get one of these. You know, the legislators, they hear from me a lot. It means a lot more when they hear from you, okay? You being up here today is very impactful. The effort to advocate for our programs doesn't end today. It doesn't end at the end of the 30-day session. It's an ongoing push. It's an ongoing effort. So please keep that in mind. Let's continue to do that. Within this RAD card, I do want to highlight a lot of what we heard today was Leah, J-Tip, J-Tip, Leah, Leah, J-Tip, J-Tip, Leah. There are other initiatives and other priorities that we are working on as a department, particularly funding, Main Street, and Office of International Trade. Those are very important programs that seed a lot of our future opportunities for the core programs and more cornerstone programs. So they're equally important. From a legislative basis, we as a department, we're going to be pushing enhanced enterprise zone legislation, and we'll be working with industry that is advocating for some changes and fixes to high wage jobs tax credit, as well as the broader tax reform. So please keep those on your radar screen. I really appreciate you being here today. I just want to kind of scan the banner and mark to see if there's anything I didn't say, Juan, did I not miss anything? Oh, and Ben has given me a reminder. Thank you, Ben. So we do, and I should notice, it's like right in front of me. We have a proclamation from the governor for Job Creators Day. Could have read this early, could have read it late. But let me just run through this real fast, and we will wrap up. State of New Mexico Executive Office Santa Fe Proclamation. Whereas one of the greatest priorities of the state of New Mexico is to create an atmosphere conducive to job creation, and whereas a healthy regulatory environment, tax reforms, and strong economic development tools have created an environment which contributes to job creation and business expansion, and Whereas entrepreneurs and inspiring business owners invest significant amounts of time and capital in a risky endeavor to provide new services and opportunities to our communities. And whereas there have been over 45,000 private sector jobs created in New Mexico since 2010. And whereas job creation greatly improves the standard of living for all New Mexicans, providing new opportunities, and allows the people of our state to enjoy an excellent quality of life. Now, therefore, I, Susana Martinez, Governor of the State of New Mexico, do hereby proclaim January 18, 2018 as Job Creators Day. Thank you very much for being here and being part of Job Creators Day. I hope you and the economic development community will carry this forward to 2019 and beyond.